the nut who said the world was going to end last year. I mean, I heard that and I went, oh, really? I mean, what part of no man knoweth the hour do you not understand? Praise God. And now, by the way, he says, by the way, I missed it. It's going to end October 21st. Oh, really? Praise God. Some of it is foolishness. Hallelujah. But the thing about getting negative information over and over and over again, it gets reinforced sometimes. And it causes us to worry. And all God didn't, that's not something that he intended for us. It's enough to worry you to death. And yet, as Christians, we are told to be careful for nothing. By that it means don't be troubled with cares or be anxious. We're told by Jesus himself, let not your heart be troubled. And then later on he says, neither let it be afraid. We're told not to be afraid. We're being told not to fear not, to take no thought for your life, what you should eat, what you should drink, what you're going to wear. We're told to take no thought for tomorrow. And, you know, when things are going, you know, as I said, some of these things are facts and things, and things that are going on in your life is confirming some of the stuff you do it. When you might go to the grocery store and say, I had enough money making this amount last year to buy groceries, but this year it's not enough. And when all of those things are going wrong in your life, whether it's the things that are happening in the economy or how the devil is wreaking havoc with the forces of nature, we hear about all these storms and all of the destruction that is around, whether all of that stuff is going on in your life, we come up and tell you all of these things, don't be afraid, be careful for nothing, you might want to say, but Sister Kim, you don't understand. And I'm not even, I heard one preacher preach this, we need to keep our butts out of the way. When God tells us something, we need to understand that his word is true and he is the final authority. Praise God. But you said, Sister Candy, how in the world then am I supposed to do this? I mean, the world I live in now, my life experience, what I feel, what I see, it all, and what I hear, it all confirms all of this negative stuff I'm hearing. So how am I supposed to be careful for nothing? To let not my heart be troubled. Jesus summed it up. Hallelujah. And if I mentioned the scriptures, and I want to apologize that I didn't give you the scriptures there, but I'm trying to hurry through the foundation for what I got to say. And some of these scriptures are going to come out later on, I promise you. Jesus summed it up in St. John 14:1. Praise God. Let's just turn there. St. John 14:1. I'll tell you the conclusion of the matter first, and then we'll tell you how we got there. Hallelujah. John 14:1, he says, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. And when he's saying believe, he's saying trust. He's saying have faith. Praise God. He's saying trust. And so my job today and what God gave me is to tell us how to trust him in the midst of all the storms that are going on, in the midst of all that is happening around us. Praise God. And he tells us throughout his word, you know, several times he tells us to trust him. In Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, he says, if you trust me, I'll direct your path. Yes. In Psalms 37, 3 to 5, he says, so shall thou dwell in the land. He says, you'll occupy my promises if you trust me. Hallelujah. You'll occupy the land. He says that I'll bring it to pass. In Philippians 4:6, he says, and the God of peace, which passes all understanding, and the peace which passes all understanding, hallelujah, he'll keep your mind, and he'll keep you at peace, your hearts and mind, through Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. In Psalm 62, it tells us to trust in Him at all times, in spite of what's going on. It says to pour your heart out before Him, because He is a refuge. He says, if you trust me, I'll be a refuge for you. And so I got to studying and wondering what this trust thing is all about. And so the first place I went, of course, was to the dictionary. And the definition of trust is a reliance upon the integrity, the strength, the ability, and the surety of a thing or a person. Praise God. It's confident. Hallelujah. And then one definition actually took me a little bit by surprise, but when I got to thinking about it, I said, okay, I can see that. It says to be bold in and secure in. Praise God. You know, when you trust the Lord, you know He's got your back, you can boldly, hallelujah, go before the throne of grace and ask Him for help in the time of need. Thank you. You can boldly tell Satan, get thee behind me. You have no dominion over me. When you trust in the Lord. And so the Lord gave me this trust as a little acronym. And I'm going to first just tell you what the letters stand for, and then we're going to go back and we're going to talk about it. Trust, T-R-U-S-T. T is to take time. R is to rehearse or remember. U is to unload and undo. S is to serve. And T is to be thankful, thanksgiving. Also to take hold and to test. Hallelujah. Praise God. So we're going to start with the first T. Take time. And you know, you guys that have heard me before speak, you know, I may sound like a broken record to you. Because I don't think I have ever got up here and didn't tell you the importance of taking time in the Word of God and in prayer. We're to take time in the Word. We're to take time in fellowship around the Word. And we're to take time in prayer. Faith, which is the root of trust there, it comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. You can't have faith without the Word. So you got to take time in the Word. The number one reason that some Christians, and I started to say we, but I don't hope nobody is like this in here. Hallelujah, because we get plenty of the Word around here. But the number one reason that most Christians fail to experience the fullness and the riches of God's blessing and total redemption from everything that comes to harm them is because they don't know.
That's true.
They don't know enough to be able to trust and have that confidence in the Lord. The Word says this is the confidence we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if He hears us, we got the thing we asked Him for. Praise God. But if you don't know, you don't even know that you can go and ask Him and get that thing. Jesus tells us in Matthew 11:29, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. That means you're going to have to come to Bible study. That means you're going to have to open up your Bible sometime other than on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. Praise God. You're going to have to study His Word. Hallelujah. You're going to have to come in fellowships where those of us who have been blessed of the Lord and have experienced His goodness can share with you all of the awesome things that He does. You're going to have to open up that Bible and realize that these stories that we heard in the Old Testament are not just stories to make us feel good, are stories to make us entertain, but it's telling us of the character and the nature of God. Jesus says that, learn of me. And then He tells a little bit about His character when He says that. He wants us to know His character. He wants us to know that He's willing to bless us. He wants us to know that He's able to bless us. He wants us to know that He wants us to be delivered. He wants us to prosper and be in health even as our soul prospers. Hallelujah. And not only does He want it, but he's able to bring it to pass for you. He's able to make it happen. Whatever that thing is, He's able to make it happen. He wants you to know that, but you won't know if you don't take the time. We also have to take time. time in fellowship and around the Word, as I said. And that includes Bible study, but that also includes fellowshipping with one another. You know, when I fellowship with Sister Dorothy, and there's some things that God has done in her life that I didn't know about. And when she shares those things with me, I rejoice with her. But when a situation similar comes up in my life, I am confident that God can do it, because I know somebody He did it for before. Hallelujah. We're the fellowship one with another. The Bible says to forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. You think God wants you here just so He can see your handsome face or your beautiful face? I mean, now really, He is surrounded in heaven. You hear the descriptions of heaven. He's surrounded by beauty. To see beauty, He don't need to see us. But the reason He wants us to fellowship with Him, with each other, and to come in His presence, to come in. He said, when He says come to prayer, He says, talk to me. Tell me how you really feel. Praise God. And see. And he often, many times when He comes, He says, see if I'll do it for you. See if I'll do it for you. Come talk to me. Hallelujah. And it's not just because He needs us to come talk to Him. He's not lonely up there. Praise God. He's got angels praising Him all the time. He is not lonely. But it is so that He can bless us. And in blessing us, our lives become a testimony. Hallelujah. Of His goodness. Of His mercy. Of His grace. Of His ability. Of His awesomeness. And He gets the glory. Praise God. Hallelujah. It just wasn't to inconvenience us. You know, sometimes we listen to the pastors exhort us to come to prayer, to come to Bible study. And then sometimes we think they even had the nerve to ask us to come an extra day in the week or something. Don't they know that we are busy? But you know, our pastors are praying for us. And they spend a lot of time in prayer and supplication for you. And they're hearing from God as to what we need. And so when they tell us to come, when Pastor Hill told us to come, it's not to make our lives inconvenient. Praise God. It's not to show that, you know, I can make them come anytime I want them to. It's not about Him at all. He's wanting you to come so you can be delivered. So you can be free. Hallelujah. Take time in the Word. And in the fellowship and in prayer. Hallelujah. It means you're going to have to study. You're going to have to learn the Word. You're going to have to hide the Word in your heart. The psalmist says, Thy Word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against Thee. And you know, God quickened that to me one day when I was in prayer. You know, when we think of sin, we think of going out, committing adultery, a lying, a stealing, a cheat. But the Bible says, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. If you are not trusting God, you're in sin. But in order to be delivered from sin, you're going to have to hide that Word in your heart.